Perfect. We ask that you please keep yourself on mute so that we can reduce some of that background noise. And please be respectful in the chat. Make sure that we're all sharing our different ideas and our different perspectives, but just be respectful of your neighbors and make sure that we can make this a really spirited conversation. Now, I will jump into a little bit about citizen schools. So hello all, I am Cassie Pierce. I'm the Senior Manager of School and District Partnerships for Citizen Schools. And our mission for the past 26 years is focused on these two pillars of hands-on learning and career mentors. And we really believe that we will help all students thrive in school and beyond by providing these two pillars. Our vision is that if we are to allow all students to have these experiences and to interact with career mentors, we're helping to ignite curiosity, build confidence, and help them to develop into the next generation of leaders. That takes on a few different views at Citizen Schools. So we have our community model, which is our currently our Makers and Mentors Network. You're going to hear from one of our Maker Fellows later tonight. And we also have our Catalyst model, which is an in-school professional development program where we work directly with educators to bring more project-based learning to our students and bring them together with career mentors. Now, one of the amazing parts of working for Citizen Schools are the partners that we're able to work with. So we have the good fortune of working with the DoD's Department of Defense's STEM initiatives. So through that cohort, we were introduced to NCWIT, who you'll hear from tonight. We wouldn't be here today without our sponsor, the DoD STEM. And we really want to highlight all of the incredible work that they do. They are the number one employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. They offer education programs, internships, and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for educators. Their STEM goals are to attract, inspire, and develop exceptional STEM talent across the education continuum. And we're going to share their website in the chat for you to learn more. Now I want to introduce Patty, who's going to share a little bit with us about NCWIT and their C4C program.
Thank you, Cassie. I'm Patty Reiners, and I represent NCWIT and C4C. NCWIT stands for the National Center for Women and Information Technology. NCWIT is a nonprofit community which was founded in 2004 with support from the National Science Foundation. We convene, equip, and unite more than 1,450 change leader organizations to increase the meaningful and influential participation of all women at the intersections of race, ethnicity, class, age, sexual orientation, and disability status in the influential field of computing, particularly in terms of innovation and development. C4C stands for Counselors for Computing. NCWIT offers the only professional development program for school counselors in the United States, which focuses entirely on computing and inclusion. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. Educators and students alike look to professional school counselors for ways to encourage girls, women, and underrepresented groups to pursue computing. But knowing where to start is really hard, even for the most experienced counselors. NCWIT can help counselors remove the barriers so students choose to learn computing, consider pursuing technical career paths, and believe that their voices can be heard in the tech industry.
Patty, you killed it. We appreciate all of your effort. And also, I hope that you feel some of the love that is in the chat for you, because everyone here is here as a friend and is here to support you. So please, please, deep breaths. We're all friends here, just here to have a conversation. So thank you so much for leading this. I really appreciate it. James, can we flip to this next slide? Because Patty, you are an expert in a lot of this data that we want to ground in on. So I'd love to hear a little bit more from you about what we're calling the encouragement gap. So what does this actually mean? What are we seeing right now?
So this slide, it's kind of hard to see it on this slide, but it's kind of divided into different groups of career growth. So the one, so my undergraduate degree is in sociology. So if you look to the right of the slide is where social sciences is. And you can see, well, I don't know how well you guys can see it, but the annual jobs is the purple. That's the purple space that's there. And the little blue with the slashes are how many men are in that career field. Mm-hmm. So next to it is the teal colored, and the women are the solid colors. Mm-hmm. And then the yellow line is women who have their bachelor's and men who have their bachelor's degree. So, and I'm looking at this, it's hard to see the slide, but if you look over a little bit, what NCWIT really wants us to focus on is the intersection between whatever our career is and X. And X is really going to be, is that art? Is that psychology? Is that sociology? Is that technology? Where is the X? So computer science plus the X. So you can see like the job growth is huge. It's 362,000 jobs that are available compared to the little purple one that's in social science. That's probably at like 25,000. I think that's about where it's at on the slide.
Wow.
So you can see like how much growth potential there is for computer science jobs compared to other degrees. It looks like engineering on the far left on my side is pretty high too.
Yeah.
So that's really what NCWIT wants us to really focus on is how do you combine computer science and whatever the X is? What is the variable?
That's awesome. And it's also really telling that from what we've talked about already, those are the two areas where women are the least represented in STEM fields, right? So these are the areas that have the most upside when it comes to growth and careers. So thank you. That's great.
Oh, yes. This is by far my favorite slide out of all the slides that we have for counselors for computing. We're like, so NCWIT is this huge organization at the top, and counselors for computing is just like one portion of what NCWIT does. But this is my why. Why is a school counselor important? And I'm an elementary school counselor, so it's really confusing. Why is the school counselor involved in this? And why is it the elementary school counselor? It's really to bridge the encouragement gap in counseling or in computing science, sorry. So I am gonna actually read this quote because it comes from this resource, and it's so telling, but by the time girls reach elementary school, girls receive and internalize negative messages about their intelligence, their ability, and their career potential. It seems that girls and women have more negative self-talk, and I'm one of those people because in my head, I'm always thinking, oh, I'm not good at math. I am not good at math. When I have to substitute teach, it's like, please don't let me have to substitute teach math because that's horrible for me. So that's all the stuff, negative self-talk in our head. And I'm going to, if you'll put in, oh, I think maybe you already did. There's research by Google and Gallup that suggests that statistically boys receive more encouragement than girls do from their teachers, from parents, and from the media. Boys are up to 2 times more likely to be told that they would be good at computer science compared to girls. So the question is, how do we facilitate this change among our girls? And that's what we're really going to talk about and dive deep in tonight.
That's awesome. Thank you so much. And you really do light up when we talk about this. So I'm really grateful that you're sharing this enthusiasm with us. I hope it's as contagious for the group as it was for me. And since we are already here chatting with you, I think this is a perfect opportunity. Patty, I know you already told everyone that you are a counselor. So can you share with us where you are zooming in from as one of our wonderful speakers?
So I'm an elementary school counselor, and I am zooming in from Pensacola, Florida, which is home of the Blue Angels.
Wonderful. Thank you. I can't wait to get more into your experience.
And thank you for being so supportive of me, you guys. I'm getting my groove. So
you are.
So thank you. I'm taking my deep breaths. I'm doing all the counseling things I need to do.
Yes, that's what it's all about. Tierra, can you tell us who you are, the role that you play, and where you're zooming in from.
Hello, everyone. I'm Tierra Davis, and I'm located in Charlotte, North Carolina. I am an eighth grade science teacher at Wilson STEM Academy.
Perfect. You got it. Nailed it. And Maggie, last over to you. Where are you joining us from, and what is your role?
Yeah, my name is, hi everyone, I'm Maggie, and I am so excited to be here with these ladies as a panelist. And I am an AmeriCorps Maker Fellow at the Northern Kentucky Makerspace. And the Northern Kentucky Makerspace is about 20 minutes south of Cincinnati. So I'm excited to be here.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And now let's pull these three lovely ladies up for some of our questions. I'd love to kick us off with one for all three of you. And anyone can jump in first. It's totally up to you. But I'd love to hear a brief story about how you got involved in computing and STEM. What was the spark for you? Go ahead, Patty.
Okay, thanks for letting me talk first again, you guys. And I just read all this chat. Thanks, you guys. I really do feel the love, so thank you. So for me, for the spark was I was invited to go to the National Math and Science Conference in Texas, and C4C spent 5 days with the school counselors and talked about why we're important and what our role is. And that changed the trajectory of my whole career, because I came back from Texas and it was, and I actually used the word spark in a couple of grants that I've written and have gotten from Escambia County, which is the county that I'm in. But it's like it just completely changed it, because I didn't know where I fit. Mm-hmm. So that was the huge spark for me.
And I'll go next. For me, the spark started with my fourth grade teacher. Her name was Ms. Harold, and she was literally like the magic school bus, Ms. Frizzle. Sorry. She was like the real life Ms. Frizzle for me. We did so many experiments. We had a pet rabbit. We dissected a frog. And all of that in the fourth grade just sparked a big interest for me.
And my interest sparked later in life, because I didn't realize all the opportunities that were available. So I think when I started to realize as a young adult and as a mom, all the opportunities, that's really when I started to start to really light the spark.
Thank you. And you are all so polite that you didn't want to be the first one to speak. So I will take that pressure off now, and I will just start assigning questions here. So Tierra, let's jump to you. I'd love to hear, as a science educator, what ways have you found to encourage the girls in your classroom to explore some of these STEM pathways that we're interested in tonight?
Yes, so definitely collaborating with citizen schools as one of their catalyst teachers has been a very engaging and exciting way to bring more STEM activities to life in my classroom. Definitely connecting with partners outside of the school to make our makerspace better, as well as to bring in the creativity. This year, I am a DOD STEM ambassador, which I am learning, and I'm making so many connections to other nonprofit organizations that I'm able to bring to my students. And although I teach eighth grade and a lot of the opportunities are for high school, I get to expose them really early and kind of push them into the direction of STEM through my class. So that's what I would say.
That's awesome. And can I ask you, because I love this example so much, you shared with me a while ago that you put together an opportunity to bring in the community into your classroom and showcase your students' work. So what did that look like?
Yes. So we had a day where my students got to create their own inventions or businesses, and they were pitched to community members. I was able to collaborate and bring in community members from everywhere, such as hairstylists, barbers, some connections that I had through other jobs and resources. People who had no connection to education whatsoever, but the students were so excited to be able to pitch their topics and their businesses and get that advice from people they had never seen before. It was like a real deal shark tank, and my students were so excited about it. And that's just one way that we can spark that in our students by allowing them to have those creative spaces and giving them the opportunity to showcase their talent.
Thank you so much. I just think it's so awesome that you did that and also found a way to bring in community members that they could see again, right? If it's their local barber and their local barber is interested in the project that they're putting together in school, that confidence and that encouragement is so empowering. So thank you for sharing that. Patty, over to you. As a counselor, you play a big role in sharing resources with girls about the trajectory of their education and their career. What are some ways that other influences in their life can help encourage them as well? What advice do you have?
excuse me. I have so much advice now for girls than I didn't really even understand before I went to Texas and was exposed to counselors for computing. But now I have so many thoughts in my head, and how do I want to expose our girls and what do I want to do? So I actually wrote a couple of, like, after I got back from Texas, I wrote a grant for Google Expeditions. And then I got a second grant, and the Google Expeditions was part of virtual and augmented reality. And it was just such a neat opportunity, because some kids don't have that exposure. And that's huge, because statistically, if we don't teach our kids, or especially our girls, that they can do it, they're not going to know they can do it. My big role is to be the encourager, and you can do this, and you've got this, much like the chat information towards me. So I appreciate that again. But so when I came back from Texas, I wrote that grant, and then I followed it up with a second grant from State Farm, and they bought some more equipment for me. And then this year, I've actually wrote a grant for Lego robotics. So we have like kits, $7,000 worth of Legos in our library. So, and we call it our Lego lab. But if we can expose our girls when they're little, then they can do anything. Because by the time they go across the street to the middle school, they are already self-conscious and they don't want to be different. They want to be different, but not different. So it's really a good way to say, you can do this. You've got this. You are coding. This is what coding looks like. So really, it's really about encouraging our girls and really just having them envision what they want to do and how do they want to do this. And in the summer, I teach actually Lego robotics at the University of West Florida. And statistically, I only have, like, out of a group of 20 kids, and I teach third and fourth graders, there's only like two or three girls in that group. And that's little. We're talking like 9 and 10 year olds. And they've already like made that connection that I'm not good enough to do this. Like, this is not for me. So if I can change that when they're in first grade and kindergarten, that's why, as a school, elementary school counselor, that's why I do what I do.
That's awesome. And you're bringing Legos into the classroom, which makes it fun, right? You're not just encouraging them. You're sparking that fun and creation that we always hope to really bring to life in the classroom. And I think that's such a great call out to this group, to take advantage of some of those grants. Like, there's so many organizations that are really interested in helping to further this. So I love that you're tapping into those resources.
Well, and just for the Title I schools that are out there, you can use Title I money to buy Legos. So just in case, I mean, we didn't, I got a grant for it, but on their website, it says you can use Title I money. So that's a good thing to know.
That's a great thing to know.
To kind of back up just a little bit, when we did Google Expeditions, we didn't want them to just be consumers of the technology, because we're all consumers. We all get on our phones or iPads and we consume it. We really wanted to teach them how to be producers of it. So we use CoSpaces, and it was amazing. And I'm not a coder, so it's amazing that I could like help them kind of bring that together.
Thank you. And you're touching on something that plays directly into what Maggie's doing this year and last year. So I want to bring it over to you, Maggie. You're a Maker Fellow. Not everybody on this call knows what a Maker Fellow is. So can you share a little bit more about what that means, what making is, and what drew you to making?
Yeah. I'm happy to talk about AmeriCorps Maker Fellows. So Makers and Mentors Network, we launched this role last year, and I was lucky enough to be a part of that inaugural group of fellows. So this is my second year of service. And AmeriCorps Maker Fellows are given very intentional and targeted professional development to help serve communities with maker-centered learning. So this also could mean maker-centered learning or even mentorship opportunities for youth, and primarily youth that are underserved. So as a Maker Fellow, we are focused on building capacity and getting more kids involved in our spaces. And some of the examples, we all do different things. There's several Maker Fellows on the line here with us, and we all do different things. I'm primarily focused on writing curriculum and then piloting new programs with the curriculum that I've written. I'm also really focused on building new partnerships in my community, and even like some of what Patty said, building funding partnerships. So that we can buy some of the things that we really want to expose girls to more like Legos, we could do that. Also, I've been even doing things like rebranding and building websites for the makerspace. So it's been lots of fun. And then making to me, this is a broad question, but making to me is like a hands-on way of learning and solving problems. And to me, it's the most inclusive form of education. And that's really why I'm drawn to making. I was really lucky, and I grew up with parents who were teachers, and so education was very much valued in my house, but I was not a traditional learner, and I really struggled in school. And especially in like the core subject areas, I did not feel confident. Instead, I was really good at like art, and I was really good at solving problems and interpersonal skills. Like I could talk everyone's ears off, and I would be friends with anyone who would talk to me. So I knew like my strengths as I was going through school, but I didn't really understand the value of those strengths. So like many women who are like trying to figure out, you know, where they fit in, I grabbed a customer service position. I had a bachelor's degree, but I didn't know like what to do with my life. And I just so happened to get a customer service job at a STEM education company. And that STEM education company specialized in youth programming. So it was really not until much later in life that I learned the value of my strengths and like what I had to bring to the table. And I was there, I was able to gain confidence and really grow into a leadership and advocacy role for STEM education. And then coming forward to now, I was really focused on national advocacy, but when my daughter went off to kindergarten, I realized that our school system, there were so many gaps just in my backyard, which is really why I kind of pivoted to really draw my advocacy into my own community, which is how I ended up being a Maker Fellow. So long story all around, but
awesome story all around. And we'll go reverse order for this next question, because I'd love to just hear a little bit more about, in this role, how do you hope to influence the girls in your space or the girls in your community in STEM through your year of service? Or how have you already started to do that?
Really, we're focused on three things. And we want girls to feel safe in our makerspace. We want them to build confidence, and also we want them to like know their value. So when I started, I'll start out with like creating that safe place to explore in our makerspace. When I started my service year, I walked in and I was surprised because the building that we use was a former manufacturing plant, and it really feels like it. So like when I walked in, I was like, oh man, we need to add some artwork. We need to add some posters. So we started to add posters featuring females in STEM careers. And we started to add artwork and working with some high school students to paint murals so that kids aren't, especially my littles, like when they would go into the bathroom, sometimes they'd leave the door open because they were scared of the manufacturing plant bathrooms. And I don't want that. I want them to feel safe and secured when they're coming into our makerspace. So that was one thing that we were doing. Another thing we focused on is there's so many studies about around how labeling materials helps these materials feel more accessible to kids. So we don't want them just to feel safe in our space, but also safe to use our materials and our equipment in our makerspace. And then the second thing we're really focused on is building confidence. And we feel there's a lot of opportunities when we remove the pressures of that co-ed environment. So we're doing a Girls Who Code, and we're also doing like female only Lego programs. And then for girls who are less focused on the technology part of STEM and maybe more focused on the arts, we are doing jewelry making workshops, which have been wildly popular with the middle school and high school students. So we're kind of trying to hit all crowds there. And then the thing that I feel super passionately about is just helping girls to feel valued. I want to like tap into that desire that really we all have to feel needed and wanted. And I am super lucky in my Maker Fellow role because I work with 8 high school females that are doing a senior internship at our makerspace. And I am constantly picking their brains. What do I think we can do to make this space feel less intimidating? And what do you think we can do to fix that? Let's paint a mural. And then I'm over the top excited when they start painting their mural. And I get lots of eye rolls and teasing because I'm called the makerspace mom. But I do feel like just that encouragement and the eye rolls are worth it. And I'm encouraging them because I do think it is making a lasting impression on them. And then one other thing we're doing really to help girls feel valued is we're reaching out to local businesses. And we're asking them if we can bring girls to their facility to talk to them about STEM careers that could be available to them. And we're really focused on these businesses knowing that we're bringing girls. So actually last week we toured a Toyota manufacturing plant, and it was a really awesome experience. The lead engineer was showing the girls around the manufacturing plant and leading them through just like the process of, you know, building cars. And he stopped in the middle of his presentation and just like pointed to the girls and said, you know, we need you. And Toyota cannot be successful without the women and the diversity that I see in this group. And I think it was a big win just to see the girls' faces when they're having an engineer from Toyota tell them that they're wanted and that they're needed and that the success of a company relies on them. I think that was super impactful. And that's something that I want to continue to keep doing at our makerspace.
Thank you so much. And there's so many things that you just said that resonate. And I feel like build on to what Tiara was talking about in her classroom, where you're building up that sense of belonging that students get when they see that adults are interested in what they're doing. So thank you so much for sharing that, Maggie. Patty, I'd love to pivot to you because you have such an interesting role with C4C. So I'd love to hear about the mission for C4C and what about it drew you into this organization, and how has working with C4C helped you to make more of a difference in your school district when it comes to really engaging these girls?
So after I went to Texas and came back, I was so excited because I'm like, oh my gosh, I can do this there, because I saw the statistics on how our girls are not encouraged. So that's really where I started. And I feel like my career has just gone up from there. And believe it or not, I actually do talk to other school counselors about being influential and really directing our girls towards careers in STEM. And we talk to, there's a lot of At my level, I do a lot of encouraging, but I feel like at the high school level, it's more, oh, what class can you take? So you see how you can, I love how Maggie said that we feel valued, because that's huge. We need to advocate for our girls so they do feel valued. And if you go into an AP computer science class, what are all the possibilities that you can do with this? And Jamie Cassup, I don't know if Kelsey, if you'll put that in the chat for us, he's a Google evangelist, and his new question that we should ask our kids is not what do you want to do when you grow up, but what problem do you want to solve? And if you reframe the question, then everything just, it's different. The perspective is different. And he has a great video, and it's only like 2 minutes long, but it is a great way to engage our kids, because what problem do you want to solve? And I ask that question now all the time, instead of saying, oh, what do you want to do when you grow up? Because they have no idea what they want to do, but what problem do you want to solve? And I think, at one of our conferences, we talked about how a young girl, she wanted to solve the problem of, and I can't remember all the details, so I could be like, you know, making up stuff, but I'm like trying to remember all the details, but even, I want to say it was like finding lost pets. It was something like that. Like that was her goal. Like she wanted to like connect all these things together, and she, that was her goal. And you can do that with an app. And you, like, we can all learn how to use, like, be a creator of an app, believe it or not, because we did that in Texas. But I really think that that's the shift that all of us, including teachers, parents, counselors, we all need to make that shift. What problem do you want to solve? Because there's so many things that we could solve. And I think for myself, like the steps that you get every day, I don't have, you know, the step thing, but I think about that's like even changed our life. Like somebody thought, oh, this is a good idea. Let's see how many steps it takes to get to a mile. And now it's a thing. And lots of people use it. So I really think just changing the question and like changing the growth mindset that you can do this. Maybe you can't do it right now, but you can do this eventually. I love the power of yet. I can't do it yet, but it's coming. So I think that's where I kind of am at in my career, because, and I feel like I've done a lot for the girls that are in my school, and at both schools in Escambia County that I've worked at, we're both Title I schools, but the school I work at now is truly, like, we are truly a Title I school, which means that we have the majority of our kids get free and reduced lunch, but all of our kids here get free and reduced lunch, but you can kind of, so that kind of gives you a good idea of maybe they don't have exposure to a lot of these things. Like even Legos, we think, oh, everybody has Legos, but maybe they don't. Maybe they didn't even know that you could code with Legos, and how cool is that? And I put this together and now it moves and it does stuff and it goes backwards and forwards and lights up, and it's all about coding. And if I can start them now, by the time they get to middle school and high school and college, they have a better idea of what they want to do and what problem they want to solve.
Thank you, Patty. I love that framing. I love that framing for myself. And I am one of those people who has walked around my kitchen island to get my 10,000 steps. So I am that person, unfortunately. And that the way that you just framed that too is really interesting to bring in one of our audience questions. And I want to shoot it over to Tiara, because you're setting up such a great foundation, Patty, at the elementary school level. But one of our participants sent in the question, how might those of us help foster and inspire interest at upper grade levels if they might not have had the opportunity to explore at these lower levels that Patty's talking about? So Tiara, I'm curious for you, being a middle school teacher, how are you able to reignite some of that curiosity in your students?
Yes. So I work at a Title I school as well. And we are about 90% Title I, 100% free and reduced lunch. And our kids do not get those experiences. And so connecting them to activities that are engaging, that are fun, connecting their experiences in the classroom to real world experiences outside of the classroom so we can make that connection for them that, hey, the daily things that you do are STEM. Just connecting them to science. I think that especially at my school, there's a big disconnect to what is science and what they actually can do. They look at it as coursework instead of looking at it as life work, as inventions and things that they do on a daily basis and how they can make those things better. So as an educator of middle school girls, I especially push them to question and to back up their questioning skills with finding the answer. So a lot of my students get frustrated with me because I don't give the answer. I say, you know what, Ms. Davis forgot, can you help me? And just pushing them into that critical thinking mode so that they can develop those skills to be able to approach scientific ideas with a, hey, I know a little something about this, because when they come into my class, they feel like it's a foreign concept, everything that I teach. And so I have to build those connections in for them. And then I engage them with the activities. I'm like, hey guys, we can do this. So when I'm teaching chemistry, I always intro it with, what do you cook at home? What do you like to cook? If your parents can go to you and say, hey, cook this for dinner, what's your specialty? And then we talk about what part of it was a part of the chemical reaction, and just inviting them into science with things that they already know so that the concepts don't seem so foreign to them. Also providing those experiences outside of the classroom, those connections to the real world, allowing them to speak with mentors that are doing jobs that they don't have connections to. Through citizen schools, I was able to connect my students with someone who worked for Dell, and they were able to ask so many questions and just get a different insight that they're not used to in their regular community. As well as someone from Colgate, we talked about toothpaste and how toothpaste is different in the United States versus Europe versus China. The flavors are different. And my students were just so amazed by that everyone did not use mint toothpaste. It was just, like I said, just exposure to that everything in life is science, and how can you connect to science, and what can, and teaching them that they have something to add, that science is not already figured out. We're inventing things every day. We're thinking of new things every day, and that they have skills that are needed in this field. And in my hopes in doing that is to push them towards STEM careers later in life when they have the option to choose.
Kira, that is awesome. And I also so appreciate that you are bringing, I feel like I'm coming away from this with all these buzzwords and phrases that I can now, life work versus coursework. Like, that's amazing. So thank you for this quotable content, ladies. You're all doing such an awesome job. And I want to be mindful of time. I am promising that everyone will be out of here on time. So I want to look through this with a lens of, we can't go back, right, to our formative years. We can't go back to our school years. But I'd love to ask all three of you, and let's start off with Maggie. When you think about school, when you think about your formative years, what advice or support could younger you have benefited from?
I would have probably told younger me to do like what I loved, and probably pursued it more and not focused on what job I was going to have in the future. And that meant like maybe pursuing a technology degree that I really liked, but didn't really feel like I felt like I fit in that space. So I think I probably would have told myself to own my inner weirdness and done what I wanted to do.
That's awesome. Thank you. Tira, what about you?
My younger self advice would be that you can do anything and do it without fear. Just face everything and run versus being scared of ideas or thinking that I couldn't fit into that space, just make room for myself and that I do deserve to be there.
Patty.
I would have told my younger self that I can be a speaker and I can do well. No, seriously. I would have told my younger self that you can do math. Don't let math intimidate you, because I really feel like I come from a generation where we weren't really encouraged to do math and science. That was like, we had safe careers, and clearly I'm in a safe career now as an adult, but I wish that my younger me would have known that I can do anything. I can do anything. And I really try to project those feelings onto my students, because they can do anything.
Yes. Yes. And this idea of safe careers, this is something that you and I talked about before this meeting too. Safe careers are what female careers were lumped into at one point, and you are all helping to break down those barriers. And I'm so grateful. And another question came in that I think is really, really fun too. So let's see if we can get to the three of you in the next 5 minutes or so. But I'm curious, what is your creative outlet, and how might this creative outlet tie into STEM in some way? So I can give, I'll give you guys a minute to think about this. Want to give you some time to let it percolate. I can share that similar to what Tiara was saying about doing kind of a food demo, my creative outlet is cooking, is baking, is anything that can result in me eating. I asked the team before we hopped on this call, what's everybody having for dinner? Because that's where my mind immediately goes. So I think a lot of my creativity goes into, ooh, can I add salt to this sweet snack? And how can that tie in? And there really is a big science element in any of my baking. Things have gone very awry if I've mixed the wrong things. And it's always fun to experiment. And I think that flavor experimentation too is something that's STEM-ish that I enjoy. Do any of you have an answer for Jonathan's question?
I can go. I am really obsessed with taking pictures and graphics. And I really enjoy that, capturing different moments. And I think in a lot of ways that comes back to STEM in engineering purposes and just in general technology and teaching, different aperture settings and different things that you can do, also including the arts with technology, and is fun for me. So
I'll go next. I like to do crafts in my spare time, just creating anything, holiday wreaths for the door, decorating. If anything breaks around the house, I have enough guts and I believe in myself that I can fix it. So I'll try to fix it first, because I can always pay someone the second time around. And so just trying to solve problems for myself. And I think that connects to STEM, just by being crafty and handy, being able to solve problems.
I feel like I don't have a creative outlet, but I like your question, Jonathan, because I feel like you could ask kids that, because they're way more creative than I am. But that's a version of asking, what problem do you want to solve? So I'm thinking my creative outlet, I really don't have one. I think I need to get one, but I feel like I could really wrap my arms around STEM. Lots of schools call it STEAM because art is included in that. But I feel like I really wanted this year to start a Girls Who Code Club, but it's not happening as quickly as I would like for it, but there's my growth mindset. It's going to come. But I feel like I almost want to learn how to really code, because some people teach themselves how to code, I think that could be a creative outlet for me. And when I'm helping the students with their Legos and coding with the Legos, I can see that's creative. And that, and they're like, their minds are just going all different ways. So I need to find a creative outlet. I think that's the answer to your question, Jonathan.
Patty, I appreciate very much the framing that you just had there. I think that your creative outlet is your students. I think that they are your creative outlet. So that's amazing too. So thank you. Thank you so much for that. James, can I ask you to pull up our slides really quick so that I can kind of round us out? And first and foremost, thank these three ladies so much for their time and their energy. It was really fun prepping for this conversation because the enthusiasm was just really prevalent in every answer that they gave. So I'm so grateful that they were able to share that with you. And I just kind of want to round us out again, reminding us how much this encouragement really matters. There's research that supports this, that we have a role to play as parents, as cousins, as teachers, as counselors, as Maker Fellows, whatever our role is. There are female identifying folks in our life who could benefit from a little bit of extra encouragement. And it does require engaging a diverse audience and being inclusive. So how can we, like all three of these ladies have brought in, bring in those authentic selves that all of our students or our young people have? And how do we make sure that we're reducing some of that unconscious bias, even the unconscious bias of these are female jobs, these are male jobs. That's something that we can do to put the work in ourselves to eliminate. We want to make sure that girls see themselves and they see concrete example of those who look like them in the tech field, in engineering field, in any STEM fields. And so we encourage you all not to be afraid to become one of those change leaders, because change leaders are people who expand and go outside their comfort zone, and they help to build community and connection. And so one way I want to share with this group an action item that was brought to me by one of my colleagues, Megan Salgado, who was really interested, and Lex, I also want to give you a shout out, Lex Rose, that the Million Girls Moonshot is an initiative that seeks to engage 1 million more girls in STEM and maker-centered learning opportunities over the next 5 years. So Million Girls Moonshot shines a national spotlight on girls in STEM, spurring action and solutions aimed at positively changing the way girls engage in STEM and inspiring them to become builders, innovators, makers, and problem solvers. And what's really amazing about this initiative, we're gonna, thank you, Kelsey, you're so quick. We shared the link in the chat, and what you can do is actually join this movement. And there are four different ways to interact. So you can get involved as a volunteer, you can get involved through a donation, get involved through your local chapter, or find a program, a STEM program near you, but they will connect you directly with those resources. So this is a really tangible way to kind of put our money where our mouth is and start taking those action items towards learning more about how to give more resources to the females in our lives and help to, again, mobilize this next generation of leaders. I also want to share and give a huge shout out to all of our Maker Fellows, both on the call and not on the call, because there was a call to action for them to just share any resources that they had on females in STEM fields or any sources that they've put together that are open source that they wanted to share with the community. So what you'll see, this fifth link is actually a resource hub that has over 30 different links to PDFs, to lesson ideas, to all different ways to interact with STEM, both in your classroom, in your home, as a guidance counselor. There's just really incredible ways to get the girls in your life excited, including one of these other links here, which is around the STEMinista project. So again, all of these uniting of communities that are all trying to do the same thing, which is mobilize this next generation. And you will all receive a copy of these resources. You'll also receive a copy of this recording because we had quite a few folks who weren't able to make it with time differences. So you will have that to share with any of your colleagues, and we really encourage you to do so. And please know that this is just the beginning of this conversation. So we hope that we'll see you at another meeting soon. And the last note that I want to make is that you will receive a survey from us over the next 24 hours. We thank you so much for your responses there. They really help us to build out what this curriculum will look like and learn directly from you what your takeaways were. So thank you again so much for your time, for the space. This was wonderful. And I'm so glad that we had an opportunity to just have this conversation. Thank you all. Have a wonderful night. And happy Women's History Month.